Hi there and welcome back. Let's move on to the presentation series called the nervous system, and in this video we will be looking at the infectious disorders, as we have been reviewing the disorders or the diseases since last few videos. So infectious disorders, we will be looking at a couple of those, and we will start with the meningitis. So meninges, we now know, as we reviewed before, inflammation of the meninges is called meningitis, or the leptomeningitis is also popularly known as. You could have a bacteria causing this inflammation, or the virus that could be causing this inflammation. And the typical symptoms are fevers, headache, photophobia, which means sensitivity to light, and a stiff neck. Okay. Antibodies and antibiotics are given to treat the more serious pyogenic form, which is basically the one that is caused due to the bacteria. And of course, the viral form is treated symptomatically until it's run its course. So that is a quick overview. So what are the signs and symptoms? You could have a fever, vomiting, headache, seizure, you name it. What are the types and causes of the meningitis? We just talked about bacterial and viral. It could be caused by fungal from the environment, and those with the diabetes or cancer or HIV positive are at a higher risk of having that kind of inflammation. Parasites are also believed to cause, although less common, but is listed as one of the category. Then we can have amoeba that we may have in warm water and the soil. That is also, for research, has been proved to be causing this inflammation. And of course, the non-infectious meningitis, you can have cancer, systemic lupus, certain drugs, head injury, brain injury. So those are also listed that could be causing this inflammation. Now, the different forms of inflammation may mean, depending upon what type of inflammation or what is the cause of inflammation, that may lead to higher or lower glucose or protein in the cerebrospinal fluid. This is a nice way to summarize what we reviewed before, that depending upon what could be contributing or triggering this inflammation, accordingly, you can have the signs and symptoms, and accordingly, you can classify them as to the different types of inflammation. And again, with the different types, but the lab findings can help. And one survey shows that the white blood cells count also supports in the process of the diagnosis. And besides that, what else can be done to diagnose this inflammation? Of course, the CT scan or the lumbar puncture, you name it, that we discussed before, or the MRI can be done to go through the differential diagnosis. This slide again reiterates that white blood cell count as a diagnostic test for the bacterial inflammation. And of course, treatment, depending upon the types and how mild or how severe it is, you could have it general treatment or other treatment, or you focus on the what is causing the inflammation. Now, this may sound like a coronavirus, but we are not talking about coronavirus. We are talking about how can we prevent the inflammation of meninges. So cover your mouth, stay healthy, wash your hands, take vaccines to prevent the disease and things like that. Of course, we know that that is not the case with coronavirus, but I don't want to sound like a stereotype. So just to make sure you are all awake, some preventative measures that can be taken here, it reiterates the same thing. And as I said, we will be looking at a couple of these disorders within this subclassification. So the first one was the inflammation of the meninges, and the second one is the shingles. So briefly speaking, that's the viral disease affecting the peripheral nerves. Blisters and pain spread in a band-like pattern over the skin following the peripheral nerves that are affected. And these shingles are caused by herpes zoster, the same virus that causes chickenpox. Okay, so enough on the infectious disorders. We will take a look at some other disorders on this nervous system. See you soon. Take care. Bye-bye.